Bruchim Aboyim, we are now on the 11th lecture on the Pesach Passover Haggadah. And Dai Dai Einu, I think it's a universal song that all different segments of Judaism, all different backgrounds sing. Dai Einu, that would have been enough. And quickly just going over what the Dai Einu says, is that had he brought us out of Egypt but not executed judgment against the Egyptians, that would have been enough. Had he executed judgment against them but not upon their gods, that would have been enough. Had he executed judgment against their gods but not slain their firstborns, that would have been enough. Had he slain their firstborns but not given us their wealth, again, that would have been enough. Had he given us their wealth but not split the sea for us, that would have been enough. Had he split the sea but not led us through on dry land, again, that would have been enough. Had he drowned our oppressors but not provided for our needs in the desert for 40 years, that would have been enough. Had he provided for our needs in the desert for 40 years but not fed us the man, again, that would have been enough. Had he fed us with the man but not given us the Shabbat, that would have been enough. Had he given us the Shabbat but not brought us close to Har Sinai, that would have been enough. Had he brought us close to Har Sinai but not given us the Torah, that would have been enough. Had he brought us the Torah but not given us the land of Israel, that too would have been enough. Had he brought us the land of Israel and not built a temple for us, that would have been enough. Now, we do not mean to suggest that we would have been content not to have received these blessings. That's not what it means. How could we imagine not having been given the Torah or Shabbat, the Eretz Yisrael, the temple, and everything mentioned in the song of gratitude? Rather, the meaning of this praise is that any one of these gifts would have been sufficient by itself to require infinite expressions of gratitude on our part. How much more grateful must we be that he has given us all of these precious gifts, the concept of Hakaras HaTov, of gratitude. And again, that's why we are called Yehudim. The word Yehuda is from the word Hodah, to thank God. When Leah gave birth to her fourth son, she thought that everyone would give birth to three. Because there were four women. When she gave birth to Yehuda, the fourth son, she thanked God, the Yud-Kei Vav-Kei, and then the Dalet. Thank God for the extra portion she was given. So again, we as Jews, all of Judaism, can be broken down to one basic thought, and that is thanks. Saying thank you to God, saying thank you to people, being grateful. And so this is what the theme of the prayer, or the Dai Einu is about. So we're going to go over it. We're going to break it down verse by verse and see exactly how we discuss this. So the first one is, he took us out of Egypt but didn't do anything to judge them. So it would have been enough for God just to take us out of Egypt, because the decree of the 400 years that were told to Abram Avinu that his seed would be enslaved had not yet been fulfilled. Also, we did not deserve redemption, and we would have understood if God had not punished the gods of the Egyptians and their firstborn, since we had not met the conditions that are being punished based on Rabbi Yitzchak Sender and his Haggadah. Now, what if Lo Asav, so again, Dai Einu, that would have been enough. What if he had just done judgment and not on their gods? So why is that special? This was, Mamloy says, was all done to show how special we were to God. And what if he had done something to destroy their gods, but not to kill the firstborn? That even killing the firstborn means even killing young children who had done nothing wrong, to show that harming the nation of Israel is such a terrible sin that even young children can die because of that. Again, something that's not usually done based on Mamloy's. And it talks about if he had killed the firstborn but not given us their money. Now, when the firstborn died in the plague of the killing of the firstborn, the survivors would have profited by inheriting more money, after all that they owned. And so God put it into their minds to give the Jews exactly that which they would have gained, based in Kiyuk of Mincha, when your child will ask. Also, according to Torah law, there's a concept, Kam Lemit Arabmine, that if one is sentenced to punishment, two punishments, one concerning his body and the other concerning his money or property, only the harsher of the two is carried out. But with this, God punished them both with their bodies and with their money. So we see again the severity of which God punishes anyone who harms the Jewish nation. Also, for all of what if he didn't give them their money, but he didn't split the sea for us. Now, God asked the Jews to borrow wealth from the Egyptians. Why? So that they would chase them into the sea. Again, so one is connected to the other. And again, the kindness of God, even to an enemy, and that the Egyptians started off welcoming the Jews at a time of famine. And therefore, they were allowed to do tshuva, to repent for the sin they had done of killing the Jewish babies in the Nile by being drowned in the sea. But they merited burial because of the hospitality that they showed, the great concept in Judaism of showing hospitality to a person. Continues with him, Eilu Karalano Sayam. What if God split the sea but didn't bring us through it? Becharava, in dry land. Now, at the sea, God revealed more than is revealed in prophecy. We know that it says that a maidservant at the crossing of the sea saw more than Yechezkel, Ezekiel, saw when he went up in the fiery chariot to heaven. So there are two acts of kindness here. One is he splits the sea for us, meaning revealed to us the divine reality that is normally concealed. Also, he led us through the sea on dry land, which means he revealed his essence, which transcends the conflicting properties of sea and dry land, thereby enabling us to remain conscious during this revelation based on Rav Dov Ber of Lubavitch. Also, God wanted to change the laws of nature for his nation. After having done so on the dry land by means of the 10 plagues in Egypt, he also wanted to do so at the sea by means of the 10 additional miracles. Afterwards, he performed 10 miracles in heaven, to also by bringing down the 10 commandments and threw them onto Mount Sinai based on Sfas Emes. Also, so as to ensure, why would he have to make them go on dry land? If we've all walked in water, it's not very level for the most part as you walk through it. In fact, very treacherous to walk. And what God did is he had the wind blow all night and it froze the sea bottom to make it level. So when the Jews walked through the sea, it was actually like a just new paved road. So it was level for them. So no inconvenience. Not only that, their feet weren't even wet. So again, that's why God did this, to make it all easy for them, just like their time in the 40 years in the desert. Again, where the cloud went before them and straightened out the land, leveled out the land, and also killed all the scorpions and snakes for them. God is always a benevolent father. We always need to remember that whenever you're praying, you're not praying to the master of the world. What you're really praying to is your Father in heaven. And this is why your prayers, and by the way, when it talks about, it doesn't talk about prayers. The strength of a Jew is kol, kol Yaakov. Kol means voice, just crying out, just like a mother hears her child's cry. The child doesn't have to say anything. Just the fact that the child cries alerts the mother and brings her running. So too with God Almighty. And it continues, what if he put us through on dry land? And he did not he had not drowned our oppressors in it. Again, support us in the desert for 40 years. Now he gave the clouds, since the Jews left Egypt with such wealth, really, that they could have supported themselves without that wealth for 40 years. So the fact that God took care of our needs shows, again, they could have taken care of themselves. God didn't want them to. Much like a parent. You ever go out to dinner with your father, he's always going to pick up the check, you know. And if he lets you pick it up, it's to make you feel good. But generally speaking, it's a father's joy to be able to take care of his son, even when he can afford it. Also, he gave us the clouds of glory, which gave us a comfortable environment. It was a sealed environment. The clouds were on all 6 sides, 4 sides of the compass, up and down. So the environment was sealed. In fact, some say they didn't even walk. That's why their shoes never wore out, because they were carried, a people mover. And their clothes were always being dry cleaned, so to speak, by the clouds as well, by the cloud itself going through their clothing. And they were led by the 7th cloud that gave them direction and protection and also light and heat at night. As we know, the desert can be very cold, so the temperature was constant all the time. In fact, the great miracle in the desert, not only were they in the desert, but they were in a Garden of Eden. because every place they stopped, the well of Miriam, which was a sea of water, we call it a well. But when you have that much water, the whole garden, the whole desert was abloom. And therefore, all the laws of agriculture did not begin until the Jews entered the land of Israel. Because if they would have had to wait 4 years for a tree to grow and this, that, and the other, it would not have worked out very well. But this way, they were able to use everything immediately. And said, "Lo hayachanu es haman," he did not, if you would not fed us the man. Now, the man was a spiritual food, food of angel, which was totally absorbed into their bodies, which made them stronger physically and spiritually. Again, you are what you eat. So this was internalized, so not only in a physical sense, but they were also, their thoughts and their motives, everything about their life in the desert was more spiritual by virtue of eating the man that they had. And then it talks about, again, eating the man. Now, and then it says, "But what if you didn't give us the Shabbos?" So what do the man and Shabbos have in common? Why are these two together? Both teach us to have faith in God. It's interesting that God, Gemara talks about why is it that God had the man fall every day. And it talks about the word lechem. Let's see if I can remember. I just learned it recently. That the three things that they would, lama, that they would look up to their father in heaven, for sustenance, they didn't have to carry a lot, and it's et cham, so it stayed fresh, hot. So these were the three things, and the word lechem is an acronym for what they had in the desert. If God would have had them get it once a year, once a month, once a week, they would have to carry it. This way, every day was delivered fresh at their door, home delivery for them, so that they would, not only that, but God wanted them to learn faith every day. They couldn't keep it overnight. That was one of the properties of the man, that if they kept it overnight, then it would become wormy and smelly, which is interesting, which is against nature. First thing, smell, then they get wormy. Well, here it would become wormy and then smelly. And for them to learn faith in God, not to leave it over, thinking that they may not have any more, that belief that God would take care of it. What's very interesting, though, is the same man on Shabbat, Friday, would be a double portion. And this is the reason why on Shabbos we receive what's called Lechem Mishnah, a double portion. That's why we have two challahs when we make our blessing on the bread. Again, to commemorate the fact that when the man fell on Friday, there was a double portion. In fact, they say that it was also Lechem Mishunah. It was a different taste, better tasting on Shabbos, even though it was an extra day. It didn't rot. In fact, it's interesting. They tell a famous story of Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi, was the one who edited the Mishnah, and he was very close with the Caesar, Marcus Antoninus, the Caesar of Rome, who some say secretly became Jewish, but others say he's very close to Rebbe. And he would eat many times with Rebbe, and one time he came over during a weekday. And didn't seem to be quite happy with the food. And Rebbe said to him, "Something wrong." He said, "You know, when I was over last time, the food tasted better. It seems like there's some spice that's missing. That seems like it's not taste as well." So Rebbe said, "There's some spice missing." So Marcus says, "Well, if there's a spice, I'll send to my kitchen. Anything you want, I can bring back, you know, if the spice missing." And Rebbe smiled and said, "No, the spice, last time you were here on Shabbos, and the food was cold, but tasted better because the special spice was the Shabbat. And that's what made everything taste better." Again, so lechem mishuna, a different type of thing. Again, the fact that it didn't rot. In fact, one of the miracles was that God had Moshe Rabbeinu at the beginning, when the man fell, take one omer of man and put it into a jar and put it into the Holy of Holies with the Ark. And it never rotted. Again, just to show that God is the one who decides what properties things will have. God can take care of any all of a person's needs as he sees fit. Then it talks about it's not Shabbos that God brought us before Mount Sinai. And again, so what if he wouldn't brought us for Sinai? And what if he would brought us to Har Sinai? Just brought us there, but not given us the Torah. Because again, one who keeps Shabbos is like he's kept the entire Torah. It's interesting. That becomes the one law that we connect all of Torah with, is the Shabbat. It says if a person keeps the Shabbat, even if he serves idols like the generation of Enosh, the first generation to serve idols, he still will be forgiven. power of the Shabbat. Truth is, the way that a person keeps the Shabbat is the way that the Shabbat keeps the Jew. I'm sure if the conservative movement had to do it again, they would not allow driving on the Shabbat. It creates Jewish neighborhoods. Once you start driving, you can live anywhere and everywhere. When you keep the Shabbat, what you do is you live within a mile of a synagogue. And your kids grow up among other Jews, and they go to school, even the public school, but with other Jews. And all of a sudden, you form Jewish neighborhoods by virtue of the Shabbat. There's so much that it does. Not only that, especially we see it today in today's society. Most families don't eat together, but even those that do, you know, everybody's on a cell phone, some Game Boys watching television. There's really no interaction, for the most part, between families. Smart families shut everything down, and that's what we do on the Shabbat. That all of a sudden we're able to be with the family with no external stimuli to be there. It's only the people that are there. I'm usually pretty busy and multitasking. I barely have 10, 15 minutes to eat. I often joke with my wife, if I could take a pill, you know, and just get it over with, that's what I would do. But on the Shabbat, I mean, I sit at a table for 3 hours. You know, it's great to be with family, to be with friends, and there's no rush. It's just a wonderful gift that God gives us. Now, it says, again, V'lo nasan lanu is the Torah, but did not give us the Torah. If God had not given the Torah, lanu, meaning lanu to us, exclusively to us, and we would have had to share it with the other nations, this would have been, again, also this would have sufficed, based on Yitzchak Sender. So we did not have to have the Torah exclusively, but God did. Even though initially, if you look at the Ten Commandments, there is a whole discussion by the Kli Yoker as to how the first set of tablets could have been accepted by the nations of the world as well. The second set were designed exclusively for us, but there's a little bit of wording between the first and the second. Also, what do you mean before Har Sinai giving us the Torah? If the Torah would not have been given, then what purpose would there have been in gathering around Mount Sinai? After all, that's what we were there for. Now, Rav Palm compares this to the Talmudic parable, a person who walks into a perfume store but buys nothing. When he walks out, he still comes out smelling better. And so too the nation of Israel, just by standing at Mount Sinai and seeing the cloud with the divinity of God, the Shekhinah on top of it, would have left an everlasting impression upon them, based on the heritage of Haggadah. And also the fact that they stood at Mount Sinai as one person was worth everything. That's a concept of achdus, of unity. There is nothing greater than it. Again, the idea of peace between all people. And again, as we know, that loving a fellow person as yourself becomes the key, according to Rekiva, the most important verse in Torah. And when your child will ask. And again, also the word Torah itself, which is interesting, has a numerical value of 611. Now, we know there's 613 commandments. So why would Torah have a numerical value of 611? Why not 613? And the answer is that if God had brought us to Mount Sinai only to receive the first two commandments, that would have been enough for us to learn out all of the Torah, because the first commandment and the second were given to us by God. Torah tzivu lanu Moshe. Moshe gave us over the Torah. They're called the five books of Moshe, because Moshe gave us the 611 commandments. The first two commandments, I am the Lord your God, and you shall have no other God beside me, were given to us directly from Moshe, pardon me, from God. And when the Jews heard the first command, they died and were resurrected with the dew of what we call Tchias HaMesim, the revival of the dead. Then they received heard the second commandment, and again they died and had to be revived a second time. And that's where they told Moshe, you know what? Why don't you hear what God has to say and tell us? So Moshe became that intermediary between the nation of Israel and God and gave over that which God said, because the Jews didn't want to keep going through this all the time. It had to be a pretty amazing experience to die and be resurrected time and again. And finishes off, two things. He'll not send a Torah like something to Israel. What if he gave us the Torah and didn't bring us to the land of Israel? Why not Eretz Yisrael and no Torah? And the answer is because the nation of Israel and Torah are inseparable. But the nation of Israel and Eretz Yisrael are not. A Jew can live without Eretz Yisrael, but not without Torah. As we see that the Jews were exiled for almost 2,000 years. And yet the Jews remained faithful to the Torah. In fact, it's very interesting that when the brothers sold Yosef to Egypt, it was really a philosophical debate, according to some commentaries, between the brothers and between Yosef. We know, how was it that Yaakov was able to marry two sisters? And one of the answers given by the commentaries is that the forefathers, Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, did not keep the Torah outside of Eretz Yisrael. They only kept it in the land of Israel. So therefore, when Jacob was outside of Eretz Yisrael, he married two sisters, and we know that when he entered the land, that's when Rachel died. So really, then he was married to one sister. So there is that belief that the land and the Torah are connected. So the brother said to Yosef that a Jew can only be a Jew if he's in the land of Israel. Once he's outside the land of Israel, he cannot keep the Torah. Yosef, on the other hand, said a Jew can be a Jew anywhere. It's not dependent upon the land, it's dependent upon the person. And they said, prove it. And they sold him to Egypt. And he was a slave, and he was in prison, and then he became the viceroy. So he went from the highest, from the lowest to the highest, and still, God was with him always. And not only that, he brought up two sons in Egypt with a silver spoon in their mouth. He was the second most powerful man in the world. And what's very interesting is that many people bless their sons and daughters every Shabbat, and at least on Yom Kippur before the service. And the blessing we give to a girl is that you should be Simcha Elokim, that God should make your name like Sarah, Rivka, Rach, Leah, the mothers of Israel, Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. And one would think that the blessing to a boy would be commensurate, that Simcha Elokim, Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, that your name should be like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But it's not. It's not even the tribes of Israel, of Reuven, Shimon, or Levi, or Yehuda. The blessing is Yisimcha Elokim Ephraim uManasseh, the two sons of Yosef, the two sons that were brought up in the Galut, in exile, in the most immoral, licentious country in the world, with a silver spoon in their mouth. And what did they do? They reached their potential. In fact, exceeded it in that they became two of the major tribes in Israel, Ephraim and Manasseh. Something that was inconceivable in the Galut, outside of Eretz Yisrael, to show that a Jew can be a Jew anywhere. And that's become certain. We love having Eretz Yisrael, and thank God we do, especially today. But that is not what is essential to our Judaism. Our connection is with God Almighty wherever we are. A Jew is a Jew. The place does not change that. And Torah is the same. And it finishes off with healing Southern Israel, below Bono Bilat Beis Abakira. What if he brought us into the land of Israel but didn't give us the Holy Temple? Eretz Yisrael is the palace of the king. More spirituality and more wealth. So again, like Washington, D.C., Lehavdil, it's a rich place to be. And this is the capital city where the king is. So Eretz Yisrael and Yerushalayim, again, the palace of the king. And again, but more than that, we see that in the next, after doing the whole Dayenu, the next paragraph goes through a repetition of everything that we just mentioned. And it says, again, one of the things that it mentions, again, about not feeding us the man. Now, how could Klal Yisrael fulfill the mitzvah of tzedakah in the desert? After all, everyone had man. So everybody was taken care of by God. All of your needs were taken care of by God. So how did anybody give charity? Plus, they came out with, it says, 90 donkeys worth of riches. And that what they got it to see as well. So how did one give charity in the desert? The answer is that the man tasted like anything you could imagine. And so the wealthier people who knew about these fancy dishes of how things could taste, instead of just simple bread and potatoes or hot dogs every night, what they did was they told them, you know, you should think about filet mignon tonight, you know, or pheasant under glass, you know, or whatever. Whatever special dish you can imagine. And this way the mom was able to taste like anything you wanted. And this way they were able to give a gift to a friend, even with the mom, and the fact that it would taste exactly the way you wanted it to taste, based on when your children will ask. Now, when it talks about, again, building the base of Migdash, and it says, it finishes off, which it doesn't say in the first part, it says, L'chaper al kalabonoseinu, to atone for all of our sins. And what does that mean? Now, this statement is reminiscent of the teaching of our rabbis in Psika Rabbah, that in Yerushalayim, no one ever went to sleep with a sin on his hands. As the verse says in Yeshayahu, righteousness rests there. What does that mean? So how did this happen that no one had sins? The answer is that the Korban Tumid, that the continual sacrifice that was brought, when the Mishkan was first inaugurated, it says that God, again, the Asali Migdash for Shachanti B'Socham, make for me a tabernacle so I can be in amongst them, that it was originally given without sin offerings. It was be actually, according to many opinions, before even the golden calf. And the main part was the Korban Tumid, the sheep that was brought in the morning and the sheep that was brought in the evening. In fact, as long as they brought that, the temple was not destroyed, either one. It's when they stopped bringing the morning and afternoon sacrifice is when the temples fell. So this was a very important thing. So the Korban Tumid, the sheep that was brought in the morning, atoned for sins that were committed the previous night. And the community offering of the afternoon was that was brought in the evening, the last of the sacrifices. The morning was the first of the sacrifices, atoned for those sins that were committed the previous day. So based on the Shibuli Halekit. So therefore, everyone that was in the city of Yerushalayim was always forgiven for all their sins by virtue of these two sacrifices. And again, it was also that which protected the temple and did not allow it to be destroyed. The next part of the Haggadah becomes very important. It talks about Rebbe Gamliel Hoya Omer. Rebbe Gamliel, who was a great Nasi, a great leader of the Jewish nation, said, Kol Shlo Omer, Shlo Shavarim Elu Pesach. Anyone who doesn't say these three concepts on Pesach, Lo Yaste Chavaso Ve'elen, does not fulfill his obligation at the Seder, and these are them. And again, what he goes through is, at my Seder, I always say it first and have everybody repeat after me. Pesach, again, which is the idea of the Korban Pesach. Matzah, again, the matzah that we have. Umar and mar. And I think what we're going to do, so what I'd like to do is, I think I'm going to stop here because this is a concept I'd like to go through. Next week when we begin, we'll begin with this concept of Pesach, matzah, and mar. Which is a major theme for the whole Haggadah, and therefore we'll be able to hopefully go through it in one lecture rather than breaking it up into a bit here and a bit there, because it's an important concept to go through. Again, I thank you for coming. God bless and be well and have a great Shabbos.